Number two, more control.
You know, this is going to be no control and easy to use.
That's 300 pages of a standard book.
In my view, this is bullshit.
Also starting today, we're inviting active fine-tuning users to apply for the GPT-4 fine-tuning.
They are few-shot learners, and this means exactly...
The model is also much better at function calling. You can now call many functions at once.
Natural language to data, and from data to natural language. And
we're thrilled to introduce GPTs.
Each Squares is not a mobile application, but it's a GPT, which is an analogous, you know. This is the Cheshire Cat. This is totally open source. You can keep your plugin secret and have no censorship and pass by nobody. So you see, you have a two-dimensional map of the memories of the cat. For example, you can call your e-commerce. You can call any service from here by... Drink me. How does the assistant know this? Because we... Hello guys, this is Piero. Little announcement, this channel from now on will be in English. Let's try this. The project Cheshire Cat AI is growing a lot, and I'm going to comment on the last releases of OpenAI, because they dropped a little nuclear bomb on us, because we did since months what they are releasing now on their platform. I'll show you later what we did.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us today.
Welcome.
Please, welcome to the stage, Sam Altman.
Over the last year, we spent a lot of time talking to developers around the world. We've heard a lot of your feedback. It's really informed what we have to show you today. Today, we are launching a new model, GPT-4 Turbo.
Okay, it's a chat version of ChatGPT. If you are new to this stuff, I'll show you something. Let me show you something. What we got so far is a large language model. Input is basically text, a series of tokens, let's say syllables. And the output is one token, and this is using a loop. You add the token here, and this is go inside, comes out another token, the token goes here, this goes inside, and that's how this language model produce language. They are distinct in three different modalities mainly. One is completion. And this is simply text goes in, the language model gives out more text. And this is not instructed or fine-tuned in any precise way. It's free text. It's trained on predicting the next token on large corpuses of data. Two is instruction / command. And they take this kind of models and they do a little fine-tuning to let him reply exactly to what you're asking. So it's a ulterior training on a dataset in which the text contains an instruction. And the language model is trained to reply exactly to that instruction. So it's a fine-tune to make it more useful. We do not see this much more many around, but if you want to, this is interesting, if you want to go deeper into this, I suggest you to take a look at this Instruct GPT, because this is the last paper they opened up, the guys at OpenAI. Train language model to follow instruction. This is post GPT-3, but before ChatGPT, that has not been published. And here you find many things that have also been used to train ChatGPT. This is from OpenAI. Yeah. So let's go back to our diagram. You don't see much around this instruction command models because the main use we do at the moment is chat. So you take a completion model and you tune it, you make an ulterior training to make it work on conversations. So imagine the user experience is you are talking with a machine. What is happening under the hood is a machine that is trying to complete a dialogue between a man and a machine. This is interesting, not really intuitive, but the prompt, the string in input contains dialogue turns, and the machine goes on, tries to complete the dialogue. So this is the main revolution here is GPT-3, and now they are selling since a few months GPT-4, which is really powerful. This was instruct GPT, and this is chat GPT-3, and now they announced the 4. So when now Sam says we are building, we are releasing GPT-4 Turbo, they are referring to this one, a chat version of chat of GPT-4. Let's go on.
Let's go through what's new. We've got 6 major things to talk about for this part. Number 1, context length. A lot of people have tasks that require a much longer context length. GPT-4 supported up to 8K, and in some cases up to 32K context length. But we know that isn't enough for many of you and what you want to do. GPT-4 Turbo supports up to 128,000 tokens of context. That's 300 pages of a standard book, 16 times longer than our 8K context. And in addition to longer context length, you'll notice that the model is much more accurate over a long context.
So, about context length, let's see. I have something to say. What they found in the literature is one that the more you the context is long, context length, for sure performance goes down. So you can paste a book and give the whole book in input to the language model, but performance will decrease. Also, you can't really expect a large level overview of the document, and I'll show you why. Another effect, this is really interesting because you find this also in humans. Depending on where in the context you are, let's call it place in context, the performance is higher for the first part of the context and higher for the latest part of the context, a recency effect. And in the middle, performance goes down. So the language model will only mostly look at the first part of what you give in input and the last part. This stuff happens because you have a series of token that you put inside the model. For sure you want these n tokens. How many tokens is the context length? So context length is simply how much text you put into the network at once. These tokens, for the nature of this architecture that is called Transformers Architecture, we will see this later, they are elaborated in a multi-layered architecture and all in parallel. So in the middle, the network will try to build attention matrices where each token is put in relation to which other token, and there will be numbers in here expressing how much each token is related to each other. So imagine to put inside these 128K tokens, you get huge matrices, but they have expedience to make these matrices smaller and smaller. But in any case, you can't expect that a network, even if it has 200 billion parameters, is going to summarize and put in high level relation every part of the book with every part of the book. This is, in my view, this is bullshit. I prefer much more to have a RAG modality, which means retrieval augmented generation. The Cheshire Cat is completely based on this on this framework. So you, the Cheshire Cat, here it is, Cheshire Cat AI. I'll show you this in the next videos. It is way better to have a small context that goes into the network, but before putting the text into the network, you retrieve from a database more information that is relevant to the query. Then you put the query tokens inside the tokens you retrieve from a database to have a small but rich context, and then you pass this to the language model.
Much more accurate over a long context. Number two, more control. We've heard loud and clear that developers need more control over the model's responses and outputs. So we've addressed that in a number of ways. We have a new feature called JSON mode, which ensures that the model will respond with valid JSON. This has been a huge developer request. It'll make calling APIs much easier. The model is also much better at function calling. You can now call many functions at once. And it'll do better at following instructions in general. We're also introducing a new feature.
Why Sam is pushing on the JSON? Why developers are asking? Let me show JSON output and function calling. What is behind this? So JSON output for sure is heavily requested because it's the best way to have the language model in an architecture where you have other pieces of software. These other pieces of software, let's say you have an invoicing program, you have a human resources manager software, you have a website. All these components in your architecture, they reason over structured data. They communicate in a network and they communicate with structured data. So having JSON as an output for the language model is a good way because you can have text as input, go to the LLM, output, it's always text, but when you parse this text, you get a JSON. So you get a data structure. Let me write just JSON. Imagine I write, show me the most expensive swimming pool in the e-commerce, and you get in output product, swimming pool, sort by price. Okay, that you can extract data from free language text, and so you can create layers, a linguistic layer on top of your services. And also the opposite is true. If you take a JSON, you make it become a string, you just serialize it, you give it to the language model, and in output you get a verbal description of this JSON. So the opposite way. So you can go from natural language to data, and from data to natural language. And this is perfect if you start to see, and I hope this is the moment, you start to see language models as a linguistic utility inside an architecture. Also here, the Cheshire Cat is, here it is, is really thought upon this. Also, function calling is related to software architecture, having the language model as a module, because function calling is basically having a prompt for the language model in which you say, you need to reply to this question. You have at your disposal a series of command to use. Command one, description. Command two, description. Command three, description. What command would you like to use? And the language model says, I want to use the command order from e-commerce. So you can go in this case from natural language directly to function calling. So both, where it is, both JSON output and function calling are two ways to have your language model as part of an architecture. And it is clear that the language model alone is not really the AI we're talking about. An AI is going to be way more complex than just a language model. That's why I created the Cheshire Cat. And also on this, I would like to say that this stuff was already into LangChain way before OpenAI launched the plugins. Because in the, oh sorry, in the world of OpenAI, they called this function callings is related to plugins, OpenAI plugins. They have a nice system. This was available in the open source world months before as tools. In the cat, you can use the tool decorator to write Python commands that the language model can directly call. And also about the JSON output in LangChain, you got parsers. It's a whole class of programs that try to extract information from the output of the language model. And now OpenAI, they decided it's so important that this deserves their own label etiquette. This stuff is available in the open source world since March, April. That's why this is also in the cut since a lot of time. But now with OpenAI, this is going really wide open to a lot of more people. But keep an eye on the open source world because it's way, you know, the dynamic that is happening is that the open source create features. Then the vendors, commercial vendors like OpenAI and many others will come. They take from the open source world, they create better and more scalable versions. So the open source world gets a crack and has to readapt to what the vendors do. Then they create something, then these things happen. And this is going on since for two or three ways. It happened already with plugins and tools. It is happening now with assistants, but let's go to assistants later.
Called reproducible outputs. You can pass a seed parameter and it'll make the model return consistent outputs. This of course gives you a higher degree of control over model behavior. This rolls out in beta today. And in the coming weeks, we'll roll out a feature to let you view log probs in the API.
Oh. Technical, but nice.
Number three, better world knowledge. You want these models to be able to access better knowledge about the world. So do we. So we're launching retrieval in the platform. You can bring knowledge from outside documents or databases into whatever you're building. We're also updating the knowledge cutoff. We are just as annoyed as all of you, probably more, that GPT-4's knowledge about the world ended in 2021. We will try to never let it get that out of date again. GPT-4 Turbo has knowledge about the world up to April of 2023, and we will continue to improve that over time. Number four.
Now Sam talks about how much the model is updated. Let me add a page. How do I add a page? Okay. So basically, when they create a language model like GPT-3, and from GPT-3, the ChatGPT, same from GPT-4 to ChatGPT-4 Turbo, they train a language model on a large corpus of text get from the web, made of web crawl, Wikipedia, books, datasets, and so on. For sure, the language model tries to remember as much as possible, but you want the language model updated on new information, like the latest news. So one option you have is to fine-tune. So get other data and retrain a little more the network on the latest text you get your hands on. But this is not really feasible because if you learn from new stuff, the network will forget the stuff before. It's called catastrophic forgetting. Another way, so that's why they have ChatGPT still at 2021, and now they say we have a new models on 2023. But this is not going to scale with time. So a better option, still I insist, is to have a RAG setup in which you have databases containing the latest info, and before sending input to the language model, you enrich the prompt. So there is a query, user says something, I query the database with the new relevant information, I put together in a prompt what the user is asking with results from the database, and that goes into the language model. I don't know if they will find a way to actually have the ulterior training of the network over the latest news, but this already works. So I don't know why and how they will do this.
New modalities. Surprising no one, DALL-E 3, GPT-4 Turbo with Vision, and the new text-to-speech model are all going into the API today. We have a handful of customers that have just started using DALL-E 3 to programmatically generate images and designs. Today, Coke is launching a campaign that lets its customers generate Diwali cards using DALL-E 3. And of course, our safety systems help developers protect their applications against misuse. Those tools are available in the API. GPT-4 Turbo can now accept images as inputs via the API. It can generate captions, classifications, and analysis. For example, Be My Eyes uses this technology to help people who are blind or have low vision with their daily tasks like identifying products in front of them. And with our new text-to-speech model, you'll be able to generate incredibly natural sound. I'll play an
enchanted by the world of sounds. His ingenious mind.
There. It also unlocks a lot of use cases like language learning. We're also releasing the next version of our open source speech recognition model, Whisper V3, today. And it'll be coming soon to the API. It features improved performance across many languages, and we think you're really gonna like it.
So this is also a lot of cool stuff. Multimodality, the point is, I don't know if it is one model, like you can have one network having two backbones before here, that you have a vision part and a natural language part. So text goes in here, images goes in here. These are networks that embed text and image on the same dimensionality, and then you have another part of the network that can elaborate both vision and natural language. Or they have totally two separate networks, and maybe they use embedding from these networks and use a database, which is something we probably will do inside the Cheshire Cat, because this is way more feasible on the open source side of things. This you need a lot of scale, but the point is they are really cool on this stuff. They are starting to mix images with text, probably with sounds. So we will need probably bigger and bigger models, or at least smart ways to embed text and vision and audio in the same geometric space, so we can exchange vectors between modalities. By the way, this is science fiction, totally sci-fi. I can't believe in just 3, 4, 5 years we got so far. You know, from 2020 on, this has been really a ride.
Okay, number 5, customization. Fine-tuning has been working really well for GPT 3.5 since we launched it a few months ago. Starting today, we're going to expand that to the 16K version of the model. also starting today, we're inviting active fine-tuning users to apply for the GPT-4 fine-tuning experimental access program. The fine-tuning API is great for adapting our models to achieve better performance in a wide variety of applications with a relatively small amount of data. But you may want a model to learn a completely new knowledge domain or to use a lot of proprietary data. So today we're launching a new program called Custom Models. With Custom Models, our researchers will work closely with a company to help them make a great custom model, especially for them and their use case using our tools. This includes modifying every step of the model training process.
This is also interesting, and it is an indicator that they are going strong on enterprise level work. OpenAI is going strong on that. I don't know how they will handle maybe there is a conflict between Microsoft and OpenAI on this, because Microsoft really wants this, I guess, my humble prediction. And so I don't know how they will orchestrate their interests on this, but so you get this network. The previous system they are still proposing is, you get the possibility to fine-tune this model we have. So OpenAI tells you have some data. We offer an API so you can fine-tune the model. What does fine-tune mean? Essentially, they will take this network they have, a ChatGPT, for example, and they will let you modify the latest layers, probably, of it. So the language model directly is more able to work on your text without using retrieval augmented generation, the database system I showed you before. And what is interesting there is fine-tuning was totally local before this kind of cloud services. Now with OpenAI, when they fine-tune a network for you, both the initial network, so this part, and the fine-tuned piece is on their cloud. So you're going to pay both the fine-tuning and also prediction. And they have different prices. If you fine-tune a network, you're going to pay for the fine-tuned network because that network will run on their machines, and you also pay that by token. So it's a way to let you fine-tune models but keep everything closed. It is a vendor strategy, commercial vendor strategy. So it's something they can do and they want to do, and it's totally coherent with a commercial intent. What Sam is saying now is that they will let you possibly, if you have a specific contract with them, I guess it's to have totally custom models. So they tell you we'll work to have a totally custom training pipeline for you, maybe starting from way before this latest fine-tune expedient. And so this will cost a lot. This is going to be really expensive, but it's going to be for a few people that are going to experiment on this. So I guess this is really big size enterprise stuff. This is for large companies that or small companies that really need a fine-tuning, but all the rest of us will probably rely on retrieval augmented generation still. I believe more and more that fine-tuning is becoming less useful. One, because costs a lot, and two, because, let me show you. And two, because if you take the paper from the paper with the OpenAI published GPT-3-4 with, here it is. And just read the abstract, what they say in 2020 when they published the paper on GPT-3 is, we scale GPT-2. It has really great emergent properties. And the main properties is that they are few shot learners, and this means exactly you don't really need fine tuning. What you really need is put relevant stuff into the prompt. So I don't know why so much people are still interested in fine tuning, but I don't know. The more possibilities, the better. Let's go back to Sam. Okay, let me skip over pricing. Basically, they reduce pricing. They are going to scale even more their infrastructure and offer really competitive pricing on this. They are going really strong. It's way, way, way cheaper to use ChatGPT over having local models. ChatGPT is mostly more powerful than analogous open local models. So we'll see what happens there. I hope we get cheaper GPU cards, but otherwise, you know, they're still really convenient to use. The only block you may have is privacy. So if you have no problems over sending your data, putting your data inside the prompts that goes to their cloud, if you have no such privacy concerns, then it's way more cheaper to just use the OpenAI API. This is true. That it is really cheap.
In all of this, we're lucky to have a partner who is instrumental in making it happen.
Okay, this is Microsoft time. Don't care.
It can now browse the web when it needs to, write and run code, analyze data, take and generate images, and much more. And we heard your feedback, that model picker, extremely annoying. That is gone, starting today. You will not have to click around to drop down.
This is about how they improved the user interface, but we already talked about the technicalities behind. I want to go over Assistant.
Going to be tremendous. At OpenAI, we really believe that gradual, iterative deployment is the best way to address the safety issues, the safety challenges with AI. We think it's especially important to move carefully towards this future of agents. It's going to require a lot of technical work and a lot of thoughtful consideration by society. So today, we're taking our first small step that moves us towards this future. We're thrilled to introduce GPTs. GPTs are tailored versions of ChatGPT for a specific purpose. You can build a GPT, a customized version of ChatGPT, for almost anything, with instructions, expanded knowledge, and actions, and then you can publish it for others to use. And
let's take a few notes here, because I want to show you what happens behind the scenes. So a GPT, about what Sam is saying, GPTs, they are composed from instructions, action, and the one in the middle was, what is it? Instruction, knowledge, and action. Instruction is custom prompting. You get a setup in which you have your ChatGPT as a base prompt, and this base prompt will be included in every request. So the GPTs will always know you are a pizza vendor, you are a canvas designer, you are anything. Knowledge is related to the fact that you can upload the documents and have retrieval augmented generation. So they will use this. I think they will probably use this kind of stuff inside the what they call knowledge for the GPTs. And actions are the tools, what they call plugins. And in the open source world, they will call plugin. So this stuff also is it's really wide open and known in the open source world. Custom prompting, retrieval augmented generation tools. This is what composes what everybody would call an agent. And in the latest period, also assistant. And now I show you about this, what we built so far in terms of just the repo, and later on I will show you the object in itself. If you go, for example, there are a few frameworks like this around the network. One of the coolest one, I think, is the Cheshire Cat. Here it is. This kind of stuff is available since like March, April, and it has already all these pieces that can be customized. You have tools, you have function calling, you have the database already included. I'll show you something. Developers, plugins, reference, tools. You see, there are ways to write custom Python functions, and these functions are going to called from the language model. This stuff is widespread since months in the Cheshire Cat, that is my our framework, but also in but also in other frameworks. So this is nothing really new, but what they are doing at OpenAI, they are making this scale a lot, and they are doing this with a few innovation. Let me anticipate what Sam is going to say, because I already saw the video. They're going to do this with a couple more interpretation of the assistant concept, which is already well established in the open source world, and I recommend you to try the Cheshire Cat, for example. They're going to make it scale. They're going to make it no code, or at least less code. And they're going to make it as a platform. This is what they are doing, scaling, because now you can have like 100,000 of GPTs of assistants on their platform, on the cloud. So this is all in a vendor, private, big American corporation point of view. You will build this stuff with no code or less code, so you have for sure less control. And they are going to open a platform. Imagine like in mobile, you have your smartphone is full of applications. And they're going to have, your OpenAI page is going to be full of little squares. Each square is not a mobile application, but is a GPT, which is an analogous, you know. There will be a GPT for booking.com, a GPT for Canvas, a GPT for whatever, and there will be, you know, a marketplace for this. So this is marketplace, market. Later on, I'm going to stop looking at the video, I guess, because I arrived at the point. Sam announces that they will even pay people with the top performing GPTs, and this is the same things that happen, for example, on YouTube for video creators, on the App Store for app creators. So this is becoming a platform and a marketplace. I like it. No, I don't like it. I think this is this big commercial platforms that try to corner the market and lock everyone out unless they pass through the standards. I don't like this. This is happening. I'm more on the open source side, so I'm going to push more to have in response to this kind of stuff. I think that we're going to scale less. So let's see this how it will happen in the open, and mostly with the Cheshire Cat, which is our framework. About scale, no scale. We're going to be local. We're going to be also a single server. Small deployments. Your GPT will run on a few machines. You have control of those machines. No need to go on someone else's cloud, because, and this is never enough to say this, there is no cloud. Cloud is someone else's computer. About no code and less code, we're going to choose a few code, quindi from low code draw lots of code. So we want assistants that are way more verticalized, way more able to do what I need on my machines, and I don't want to go through their platforms. I want to write more code to have more control of what the assistant will do. And about platform market, no platform, but interoperability. I think in the open source world, we must fight for our place and have common shared standards to, sorry, let me move my face up here. To have common shared standards so we can have no central platform, but we can interoperate our frameworks and our assistants so they are able to talk to each other. And so basically it all will be a synthesis between this part of the diagram, so the commercial side, what OpenAI is building in a beautiful way in their point of view. This is really cool if you are a capitalist. This is going to be no control and easy to use. What we are building in the open source world will be 100% control. Also on the language model side, I am among the people that can't wait to have open, small local models that are on par with ChatGPT and, Mistral, Zephyr, Llama, this kind of models, they are going to reach a good performance ability, and we will use them instead of OpenAI models. So 100% control, hard to use. Before we reach the level of easy of use, this kind of platform like the OpenAI platform is going to offer to consumers, open source has a long way to go, but this already happened with browsers, with operating system, with content management system. But now, thanks to the open source movements, we have Linux, we have WordPress, we have Django, we have Firefox. So this kind of gradient, this kind of differentiation is also way more there is a gradient between these two parts, because, and let me be more clear of this, you have a vendor side of things, commercial, big corporation, and also an open source side of this. As you see, open source already uses commercial models. Commercial vendors rely a lot on open source to inspirate and produce their products. Also, you saw OpenAI released Whisper. This is a way for them to contribute a little to the open source world. And there are a lot of things you can do in the middle. It is not vendor or open source. It's going to be a whole industry. This is not a simple market, this is an industry. And so, guys, keep your eyes open. Because a lot of stuff is going to happen. Try the Cheshire Cat, here it is. And I will try to make a playlist about the cat, how to use it, because, I'm going to show you the cat at the moment. Now, since the video is already long, who cares? I'll show you the cat live. Here it is. This is the Cheshire Cat. This is totally open source GPL license, guys. So have fun with this. Let me move. Okay. There is a light mode and dark mode. I'll show you these pages around in a while. Let's ask who are you? As you saw, when talking about GPTs, Sam Altman told there are instruction, function calling, and knowledge. I will show you this stuff in here. Who are you? The assistant already knows who he is, and you can change this via plugins. So there is no need to write each time a prompt. You can activate a plugin, which are here. These are all community contributed. Jerry Scatti, summarization, pizza delivery, a search engine, search for music, multilinguality, latest news. There are a lot of plugins inside of here. Thanks for all the contributors who are helping with the cat and writing plugins. But you know, there is no need to have a separate conversation. This, the cat remembers anything. You can learn, you can upload the internet addresses. Let me move the face. You can upload the memories exported from other assistants. You can upload an address, and the cat will go on the address and parse the text and put it into memory. And you can upload files. For example, let's upload a file. I'm gonna update Alice in Wonderland. It's going to take it. Let me show you around in the meantime while we load the Alice in Wonderland text. You can change language model, and you can change the embedder. This is quite easy to do. In the case of the language model, for sure you can use ChatGPT and put your key here, but you can also use Cohere, Hugging Face, Azure, Anthropic, and Ollama. This is an open source runner. You can use each open model from Ollama, Llama, Mistral, Zephyr, anything. And you can also give Llama CPP Python, and you can, which is another really famous open source runner for open models. And you can use a custom API from which, you know, the call calls your endpoint. You are expected to give back text over the prompt. Same thing, you can change the embedder. There is an extensive documentation. Plugins already show you. It's easy to join the plugins. You can also apply to have this your plugin listed in the official registry, which is on GitHub, so you can apply no problem. But you can keep your plugin secret and have no censorship and pass by nobody by going here, upload plugin, and you can upload a zip. So you are free to do what you want. You can exchange these plugins any way you want. You can write them yourself. So you are there is no block, no vendor lock-in in this stuff. Memory, this is cool. So you see, you have a two-dimensional map of the memories of the cat. For example, let's say Bottle near Alice. This is the query. These are pieces extracted from episodic is something that I asked the cat before during my demos. You see, this is all questions that came out from conversations. And also these green dots are pieces of documents. This is a piece of the text I just uploaded. So you can really search through the cat, the assistant memory. And also yellow dots, the functions. The function the cat can call are also in the memory, and so you can have a list of functions, you can search over them, you can have fun with your Jarvis at home. So let's go back into the chat. 93% of the book has been uploaded, but what was written on the bottle near Alice? Drink me, how does the assistant know this? Because we uploaded alice.txt and there is a chunk of text talking about this stuff. So you can see why the assistant, the cat, replied to your question in such a way and what is the similarity score between your query and the chunk of document and also the source. You have episodic, this is conversation memory, declarative document memory, and procedural is the tool memory. For example, here I ask what time is it? The assistant knows what time is it. Why? Because there is in procedural memory, a function came out called get the time, and you can write any function in your plugins. this function got called and the output went back into the chat. So you can call your e-commerce, you can call any service from here by writing plugins. And this is already extensible, it's fun, and I hope you want to try it out. I'll leave you the link in the description. Search for Cheshire Cat AI. It's just a few couple of commands to bring it up via Docker. It's already all included. If you want to use ChatGPT, you need your ChatGPT key. Otherwise, you can use Llama and run with a local model. Have fun. I will come back soon with a playlist on the cat and how to write plugins.